and it's lasting all week long. Can you hear it? Can you feel it? It's the rhythm of a gospel song. Oh, once you choose it, you can't lose it. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. I got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. I've got a heart overflowing cause I've been restored. There ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. No, there ain't nothing gonna steal my joy. In the valleys that I want, clap your hands and stomp your feet till you find that gospel beat, cause it's all you'll ever need, all you'll ever need. Clap your hands and stomp your feet till you find that gospel beat, cause it's all you'll ever need, all you'll ever need. I've got an old church choir singing in my soul. I got a sweet salvation and it's beautiful. Steal my joy.
And darkness tries to hide and trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great.
your hidden glory in creation, now revealed in you, our Christ. What a beautiful name it is. What a beautiful name it is. You say,
the name of Jesus
powerful name.
right. Good morning, Eastside. Good to see you this morning. Thank you for taking time to be with us. Let's begin with prayer. Father, we love you.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you for the joy of gathering together. Father, even if it's at a distance, we're still near you, for your presence is always with us.
Thank you, God.
And we thank you for that, Lord. And we pray, Father, as we do gather around your word, that, Lord, you'll touch us, that you'll inspire us, that you'll encourage us, and even, yes, Lord, and rebuke us, Lord, so that we can be closer, grow stronger in you.
Yes.
We love you. Thank you for this day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So we are continuing this morning on the book of, or on He Is, but we're going to the book of
Zechariah.
Zechariah. And so, Laura, if you will start sharing with us on that.
Absolutely. So hopefully you've been in your word this week as we are going through the He Is series, as Randall mentioned, one book at a time. Well, I guess that's not true because the prophets, we did a few but together. But the point is we're going through the course of the word, going through the books, and in each book, we see Jesus. And so as I went through the book of Zechariah, the most obvious thing there was the promise of Christ to come. But there were a few things that really stood out to me that I wanted to share with you this morning. Just the book in its whole, we see God calling his people to repentance. That's been a common theme throughout the books of the prophets. We see God encouraging his people to trust him. Again, a common theme. We see God instructing his people how to live. Once again, common theme. And God is telling his people of a glorious time to come. Here in the book of Zechariah, as I mentioned, Jesus' ultimate coming. So as I look specifically at a few of these verses, this is what stood out. God is faithful to his promises, but his blessings are conditional. And see, sometimes we get that confused. We love to claim the blessings of God, and then when life doesn't quite go the way we think it ought, then we're quick to turn and question God's presence, his promises, and his blessings. But while we know that God is who he says he is, and he's true to his word, however, he holds us accountable for our actions, for our attitudes, for our interactions, right? And so in Zechariah 6:15, the Lord says here, that there's going to be a time when people are going to come from far off. They're going to gather together, rebuilding of the temple. And you shall know that the Lord of hosts has sent me to you. This shall come to pass if you will diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God. Now, I want you to listen to that. That was Zechariah 6:15. I apologize. I don't think I gave you the reference. But listen to what he said. Again, he's telling them of a promise, right? A blessing to come. And he's telling them, again, it's going to be confirmed that it was the Lord who brought it about. But he says that it will come to pass if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord. So God's going to do it. The question is, do you want to be a part of what God's doing? Do you personally want to experience the blessings of God? Because he longs that you should experience them. He longs that you should enjoy them in your life. But in order to do so, you have to be obedient. And so what we do matters. He then continues in Zechariah chapter 7, verses 8 through 13. The word of the Lord came to Zechariah saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, render true judgments. Show kindness and mercy to one another. Do not oppress the widow, the fatherless, the sojourner, or the poor, and let none of you devise evil against one another in your heart. I like that he said in your heart, because you may read that list and you may think, I'm good, good, good. But then when you get to the devising of evil, sometimes we like to cultivate evil in our hearts, feeling as if we're not acting upon it, then we're innocent. Of course, we can point to multiple scriptures that tell us that what we do in our heart, we are guilty of. And this is just one more reminder that it's important. It's important what we do, how we live, and what we allow to dwell in our hearts. The scripture then continues, but the people, they refuse to pay attention. They turned a stubborn shoulder, and they stopped their ears so that they may not hear. They made their hearts diamond hard, lest they should hear the law of the words of the Lord of hosts. Therefore, great anger came from the Lord of hosts. And as I called, don't miss this, As I called, they would not hear. So they called, and I would not hear, says the Lord of hosts. Whoo! I mean, you know, when I heard these words, I had to stop, and I went back and back and back. Because, again, there's so much in these verses. God is calling us to lead our lives in a way that is befitting of him. Randall spoke of that in the study this morning in Acts chapter 6. If you were part of Bible study, you heard that. If not, you need to go back and listen. He talked about what we do matters. And the thing is, as believers, we are called to lead our lives in a certain way. We're without excuse. We have the Spirit of God. We have the Word of God, which enables us to develop, as he mentioned this morning, the character of Christ in our life. We should exhibit that. And see, what we think, again, just like we think God owes us his blessings, regardless of how we live, and when we're not reaping the blessings or the benefits of God, we're quick to question God. Equally so, we like to believe that God hears us no matter what. But that's just not so. Because see, what was happening here is these people, they would call upon the Lord, but guess what? They weren't calling out in repentance. They were calling out in help me. Does that sound familiar? We love to call on God for deliverance. We love to call God, heal me, God, fix me, God, save me, get me out of this trouble that I've gotten myself into. But rarely do we like to call to confess and to repent. And the reality is, if you're unwilling to confess and if you're unwilling to repent, God will not hear your prayer. He hears the prayers of the righteous, not we're not righteous, right? It's Christ that's made us righteous, but it's a righteous cry to God, a righteous call to God is one of humility, one of repentance, one that desires God's will to be done. And so then he goes on, and again, as I mentioned, as you go throughout the entire book, we have the call to repentance, and we have the teaching of how we ought to live, and of course, the book sums up in Christ to come and the blessings. And I loved this verse in Zechariah chapter 8, verse 23, because this says the Lord of hosts, in those days, 10 men from nations, from other nations, of every tongue, shall take a hold of the robe of a Jew. Or another version I read said, the sleeves, they're going to grab your sleeve to cleave to you. Why? It says, listen, let us go with you, because we have heard that God is with you. And when I heard that, I thought, wow. You know, that should be the mark of a believer, that we lead our lives in such a way that people literally want to be with us. They grab hold of us because they understand that God is with us. So for me, I encourage you to examine the book and consider, you know, where are you? Are you at the point of the need for repentance? Are you at the point of just needing to grow and understand how you ought to live? Or are you celebrating the victory of Christ and in the Christ-filled life, the life that leads others to God?
Man, who knew Zechariah had so much, right?
Yeah.
I look at the minor prophets, and they're only called that because they're small books. They're not called that because their messages are any less important than any of the rest of the prophets. But I look at that, and so many of us don't glean things. And that scripture where it says, you can call on me, I'm calling on you, but
you won't listen,
so yeah. When you call me, I won't either.
Yes.
Ought to be a stark reminder, especially to America, but to all Christians around the world, that just because we're God's does not mean that God is going to hear us.
Right.
It depends on our lifestyles and how our relationship and how we're quenching the Spirit. And so just a great reminder. I want to give you a couple of announcements. Number one, remind you that the Student Alive Ministry will be on tonight at 6 o'clock. And so I want you to tune in to that. And then this week we're going to start back with the Secret Chamber. And so hopefully at 9 a.m. those will post every day. And then by way of church announcements, we have two. Randy Copeland is Marsha Copeland's husband. They came several years ago, Marlon Hampton's daughter and son-in-law. She was teaching at Duran and at Polk State, and that's how you can remember her. Well, they moved to Turkey. I lose track of time, so maybe 2 years ago. Katie, who works in our nursery and preschool department, is their daughter. And anyway, he contracted the COVID and is on a ventilator in Turkey. But I heard word today that they're taking him off. I think it said today that they were bringing him out of the coma and that he was doing better and was healing. So praise the Lord for that.
Amen.
The other prayer request that we have is Mr. John Stevens is in the hospital with pneumonia over in Lakeland. Obviously, no one can go see him, but we want to pray for him. We know John is a great man of faith and loves the Lord, so there's no question about that. But we'll pray for him and his family and the doctors and nurses and those that are ministering to him as well. Church is doing well, so thank you for your prayers. Continue to pray over it. We're going to have a time now where you'll have the opportunity to give your tithes and offerings. So please take advantage of this time, and then we'll be back.
We knew he was dead. It is finished, he said. We had watched as his life just ebbed away.
Then we all stood around till the guards took him down. Joseph begged for his body that day.
It was late afternoon when we gathered to the tomb, wrapped his body and sealed up the grave.
So I know how you feel. His death was so real. But please listen and hear. Was her reason for tears. And I sobbed in despair. My Lord is not there.
He said, child, it is I am here. I just see.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
All right, church family, we're going to gather around the table in just a moment. But before we do, I'm looking at our live, and I'm seeing the Avila family is here. Also, the Phillips, Jeff Phillips and Rhonda Phillips are here. Tammy Bertoncini is here. Mary Singletary. Mary, wake Sammy up. I'm sure he's asleep. They're here. Tyler Bristow is on with us. Aaron Dansby, I know who he is. I see him right there. Terry Hughes is on. Millard and Kathy Duncan are here. It looks like the Davis family, that'd be Elliot and Karen and Kayla. Welcome, guys. We're
Cameron.
Glad y'all are here. Who?
And Cameron.
Oh, yeah, Cameron. Yeah, I hadn't met her, I don't guess. And then Mark and Libby Miles are on. The Duncan family is on. The Rambo family is on. Marlene is on. Nancy Egbert is on. Oh, there's Grant Fowler. I see him. And Justin Derrick. So those are people that I see. Oh, wait, there's more. The Lindell family is here. Nancy White is here. Sally Malalou is here. Jessica Phillips is here. Vicki Short is here. Amanda Jernigan is here. And so I see a lot of y'all. Thank you so much. I try not to look at the scrolling while I'm preaching because it distracts me, but I am so thankful that all of you are here. God bless you. We're going to sing the table this morning, so sing along with me. I can hear you, so sing it out loud.
Amen.
I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. And I won't hunger anymore at His table.
Yes, amen.
I will feast at the table of the Lord. I will feast at the table of the Lord. I won't hunger anymore at His table. Come all ye weary, come and find. His yoke is easy, His burden light. He is able, He will restore at the table of the Lord. There is peace at the table of the Lord. There is peace at the table of the Lord. I won't worry anymore at His table. There is healing at the table of the Lord. There is healing at the table of the Lord. Oh, and I won't suffer anymore at His table. Oh, at His table. Come all ye weary, come and find. His yoke is easy, His burden light. He is able, He will restore at the table. Oh, oh, I know He has a place for me. Oh, what joy will fill my heart with the saints around the mercy seat of God. Come all ye weary, come and find. His yoke is easy, His burden light. He is able, He will restore at the table.
table of the Lord.
Here's the really good news.
Well, I'm invited to the table of the Lord. I'm invited to the table of the Lord. And he says, come just as you are to his table.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. By the way, while I was preaching, Cindy Jacoby's known for this. While I was singing, Cindy Jacoby sends me a message that says, I'm here too. FYI, we're glad to see y'all. So if you got your Bibles, turn with me over to Zechariah. We have, as Laura says, we've been on a journey through the almost complete Old Testament. We got one more book, almost through the Old Testament, looking for Jesus and looking for nuggets of inspiration that will grow us into what God would have us to be. So I'm looking at the book of Zechariah, and I look 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 at the book of Zechariah, and I keep thinking, okay, Lord, surely there is something, because there is so much there. I don't want you to get the wrong impression, the wrong idea. It's not like there isn't stuff there. There's just so much there, so many different directions you could take. But I know God just had a message for us this morning, so if you have your Bibles, and I trust that you do, turn with me to Zechariah chapter 4. We're going to be focusing in on verses 1 through 6. We may go all the way down to 10, but I want to focus on verses 1 through 6. And so the title of the message today is God in the Small Things. And so sometimes in ministry, in church, or as you look around you personally, sometimes you get the idea that God is only about big stuff, and we often only think of God when it's a major crisis or when there's a major decision that has to be done. But I want you to understand that God is in those things, but God is in the small things. And so I began to think about where God has used just small things. And I want to remind you, Moses' staff was just a piece of wood, yeah, but it parted the Red Sea, and it brought water out of rocks. I want to remind you that David's sling was just something that he had with him. It was just a tiny, in most people's eyes, an insignificant thing, but it brought down a giant and defeated a nation. A jawbone of a donkey. Somebody said that reminded them of Kenny. I don't remember who that was, but someone said, but it was a jawbone of a donkey that slew 1,000 Philistines by Samson. A hammer and a tent peg. You don't think, well, what is the big deal about that? It saved a nation. A piece of rope, you remember from Jericho, and the scarlet rope that she let the spies in, also was there proving as her salvation. It was what saved her. It was just a little piece of rope, a basket, an axe. Lord Paul down or Saul down so that he wasn't killed. Just a simple basket. Fish and two loaves and fish. What is it? How many loaves did he have? Bread and a fish.
two fish.
Yeah. That it just something insignificant, especially when you look at the crowd. There's no way that this can happen. A cup of water, Jesus says, if you'll just offer a cup of water in my name. Mud he used to heal eyes. So I want to show you, those are just small everyday things that we all have, and we somehow think that God can't use those things. And so if you're in your Bible, I want you to remember, there's no such thing as an insignificant thing when the power of God is on it.
Amen.
There's no such thing as an insignificant person when the power of God is on them. So Zechariah chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, the angel who had been talking with me returned and woke me up as though I'd been asleep. What do you see now? He asked, and I answered, I see a solid gold lampstand with a bowl of oil on top of it. Around it was seven lamps, each having seven spouts with wicks. And I see two olive trees, one on either side of the bowl. Then the angel asked, well, what does this mean, my Lord? Then I asked, what does this mean, my Lord? What do they mean? Don't you know, the angel says? No, my Lord, I replied. And then he said, verse 6, then he said to me, this is what the Lord says to Zerubbabel. Now, you remember that God has spoken to Zerubbabel in several of our messages. Zerubbabel was has brought the people back into the land. The temple is restored. The foundation has been laid. They've been tasked with rebuilding the temple. Remember, they have the great wailing because this temple is smaller than the other temple. And then Zerubbabel is looking around. Remember last week, God told Zerubbabel, don't worry about the nations around you, how much stronger they are than you, because I've got you. Zerubbabel, in their eyes, most of you didn't even know who Zerubbabel was. And truthfully, in the eyes of the nations, most of them did not either. He was an insignificant person to them. He wasn't a major player on the world scene. He certainly didn't have a major army. There was no economic power in Israel. They were just getting back on their feet. The land had been decimated and foreigners have moved in. And so the land is struggling. They have no gross national output. They really have no gross national. I mean, there's just really a group of ragtag people that have come back into a destroyed land and are trying to build back some semblance of life. And so in the scale of the world, this is a very insignificant nothing. But that's not how God sees them. And I think in our lives sometimes, we look at our current situation, and well, nobody knows me. Nobody knows my name. My life is not meaningful. I'm not on the big scene. I don't have the big purpose. And I just want you to know, if you have the power of God, you are the most significant thing in your place.
Yes, amen.
You are so significant, even though if no one ever acknowledges, the King of Glory acknowledges it. And so God says to Zerubbabel, don't worry. But look what he says to him here, it is not by force nor by strength, but by my spirit.
Yes.
It is not by force and not by strength. In other words, it's not by military army, and it's not even by the strength of your back, Zerubbabel. Those things are important, but it's my spirit leading you. That's the important thing.
Amen.
It's the power of my spirit in you that is important. Turn with me over to Kings chapter 19, verses 11 through, well, I'm going to go through actually 9, but 11 through 15 is where I want to. This is the prophet Elijah. And Elijah has seen some pretty amazing things in his ministry, and he is a major player in his area, and yet Elijah is running. The people are turned from him. Elijah is hiding in a cave. So in verse 9 of 1 Kings chapter 19, 1 Kings 19, verse 9, then he came to a cave where he spent the night. But the Lord said to him, what are you doing here? What are you doing here, Elijah? Elijah replied, I have been zealous. I have zealously served the Lord God Almighty, but the people of Israel have broken their covenant with you, torn down your altars, and killed every one of your prophets. I am the only one left, and now they are trying to kill me too. Elijah, the great and mighty prophet, has been condensed down to this small, I'm all by myself, poor old me. I want you to understand, that's where Satan wants you, is where you're wallowing in self-pity or self-doubt that God can't or won't use you or do great things through you. And so now here's this great and mighty prophet, and he's in a cave hiding for his life with this mentality that, God, I want to serve you, but everybody's trying to kill me, and I got to run. I got to go. So here you go. Go out and stand before me on the mountain, God says. Elijah went and stood there. The Lord passed by, and a mighty windstorm hit the mountain. It was such a terrible blast that the rocks were torn loose. That's a pretty mighty blast.
Yeah, amen.
But the Lord was not in the wind. Wait a minute. Mm-hmm. Go stand out on the mountain, the Lord told him. And Elijah stood there. Now, I want to tell you that if the wind is blowing so hard that it blows the rocks off, how hard do you reckon it's blowing against Elijah?
Yeah.
And yet, there's no recording that Elijah was moved. The rocks were, but not Elijah. What held him there? The power of God.
Yes.
And then God says, not in the windstorm. In other words, Elijah, we have the tendency to believe God is in what we can feel that is powerful. And that's not always so. God is holding us steady in what's coming against us sometimes.
Amen.
The windstorm, it was so terrible, the rocks tumbled, but God was not in the windstorm. After the windstorm, there was a tremendous earthquake. The whole of everything around Elijah is being rocked. Elijah's not. The Lord wasn't in the earthquake. Elijah's standing firm. After the earthquake, there was a fire. But Elijah's not burned. There's a fire here. So we got a mighty windstorm that blows rocks off the hill. We've got an earthquake that decimates everything but Elijah. And now we have fire that burns everything but Elijah. But the Lord wasn't in the fire. And after the fire, there was a sound of a gentle whisper. Now look at verse 13 because it's crucial. When Elijah heard it. Now listen, what he's just faced is four incredibly noisy things. The windstorm, the earthquake, the fire. And yet God isn't in any of those things. He can still hear him. And I think sometimes in our life, we are so focused on the storm, the fire, or the earthquake, that we don't listen for the voice of God. That must be God. No, God is powerful, absolutely. But God doesn't need wind, God doesn't need the earth to quake, and God doesn't need fire to accomplish his purpose. What he wants, what he uses, is people that have ears that can hear him.
Yes, amen.
He wrapped his face in his cloak and he went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. God says again to him, Elijah, what are you doing here? And he replied, I have zealously served the Lord God. He hasn't changed his message for the people, and I too am here. Look what verse 15 says. Then God told him, go back the same way you came. In other words, get back on track, dude. Stop whining. Put your big boy britches on and learn to listen to me. I either am able or I'm not. Is God able?
Yes, amen.
Either he's God or he's not. And it's so easy for us as humans to forget that he is able because we're focused on the fire or the wind or the earthquake or the virus, that we forget God is able to do incredible things in this time.
That's right.
Some of you haven't done anything since the virus hit because, well, I can't do anything, Brother Randall. You've got more time to do stuff now than you've ever had.
Yeah.
At what point will you do something if you won't do it now? When are you going to do it? God says, go back and get on track.
Yeah.
Look with me at Ephesians chapter 3 for just a moment. This is one of my favorites. This is Paul. Ephesians 3:20. Now all glory to God. There's the motivation. There's why we do what we do.
That's right.
All glory to God. We are bringing God glory. Now watch this. What's the next word?
Able.
Able.
Yeah.
That is a proclamation of faith.
That's right.
Now, Paul, out of all people, knows what it is like to be naked and hungry and beaten, and whipped and stoned and alone and rejected and despised and rebuked. And he knows the whole genre of why we should stop. Satan has thrown everything he can at Paul, and yet Paul doesn't stop. And the reason Paul doesn't stop is not because he's a fool, but because he knows God is able.
That's right.
God is able. See, you're not. And that's the key to here, is you're not able. Mm-hmm. What you need to know you're able to do is you're able to hear God. I mean, that was the only change, was that Elijah could hear God. And now Paul can hear God. And in the midst of all his trouble, he's saying, all glory to God, who is able.
Yes.
Now look what it says, through his mighty power.
Yeah.
Through his mighty power. Wow. But I love the last little bit of that. Mm-hmm. At work where?
In us.
Hot dog.
Yes.
At work, where?
In us.
In us. God is able. His mighty power is where?
In us.
In us. And it's working.
Yes.
It's working. But thank look Lord. What it's working to do. To accomplish infinitely. More. Infinitely. So let me explain to you, because some of you come from Alabama. Infinite means if you point this direction and you point this direction, and those two points never meet, and they continue out infinitely, that's infinite. It just keeps going and going and going, and there's no end. So God, it can accomplish infinitely more. In other words, there's no stopping how much more God can do than we could even ask or think. You can't even imagine the power that God has for you.
That's right.
I mentioned Zerubbabel. He knows now, I'm sure, but he would have never known that the Messiah was coming through him. He could have never known that. He's looking in his moment of God's will, he has been tasked with the responsibility of overseeing God's people and rebuilding the temple. That's his task. And he's been getting, it's a horrible task. A, have you ever tried to deal with a bunch of people who ought to be good but aren't? And B, he doesn't have the resources to do what he needs to do. And so he's having to look. There's no plan. He's not a builder. And so there's really, it's just, I got to trust God because he's given me something that I can't do.
Yeah.
And he's looking at that, and I know on the day that the temple was finished, it must have been an amazing thing. Zerubbabel may have believed that was the end of his contribution, that's all God was going to do through him, was, okay, I got this temple built. That's pretty cool, and that's amazing. No. God was building through Zerubbabel a temple that couldn't be broken.
Amen.
The temple that Zerubbabel is building is going to be destroyed again.
Yeah, that's
right. But not the temple of Christ, not the temple of us.
Amen. Praise
God. And that's just one example of how God can take our obedience and do infinitely more than we could have ever hoped or imagined. If Zerubbabel is able to look down now and see, he'll say, he's hot-dogging hallelujah.
Yeah.
Look what God did. Who knew?
The Lord knew.
Who knew? God knows.
Yes.
And so I just want to encourage you, church, this morning, that you may feel small, and where you're called to serve may feel insignificant. And you may not see great results, but God is in the small things.
That's right.
And all of those small things make a mighty work. I was thinking when I read this, I was thinking about 2 or 3 weeks ago, we were talking about the destruction of Nineveh. And I love the study of Assyria, and it's just something I like to do. And if you could grasp how powerful the empire of Syria was, and how impregnable the fortress of Nineveh was, we have no reference point in our generation, but it is impossible to take that city. It's impossible. And any army that has tried to take it, got to it, and tried, even the Medes and the Babylonians are trying their best to take it. They are sieging it, but they can't take it. And then all of a sudden a rain starts. And it's just an insignificant rain. But all those drops joined together in an effort. And what brought that city down was the flood. It broke their defenses so that the Babylonians and the Medes, go study it for yourself. You don't take my word for it. Go study it for yourself. Micah said that was going to happen. He said his prophecy. What God said through was in his prophecy. All the Ninevites had to do was read his prophecy. They would have known, hey, we better find some way to block that river. It's coming through here. But they didn't, because they didn't listen to God. All those little seemingly insignificant raindrops brought the most powerful empire on the planet down. Just a raindrop. What can God do with you? What will God do with you? My Bible says infinitely more than you can even think or ask.
Yes, hallelujah.
You just got to hear his voice.
Yeah.
You just got to understand that the power is God's.
Yes.
And God is able. Let's pray.
Amen.
Father, we love you.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, we look at I look at my circumstances, and sometimes, Lord, it seems impossible. Mm. Sometimes the task that you assign me, I'm not equipped to do. And Lord, thank you that you're able. And that you're teaching me that it isn't about if I'm able.
Thank you, Lord.
It's just about if I'm willing.
That's right.
If I can hear you. Mm. If I'll get away from the noise. Mm-hmm. Stop looking at the storm. Mm. And hear you.
Yeah.
And then, Lord, in hearing you, that I will believe you.
Yes, God.
Well, Father, you have a purpose and a plan that is infinitely bigger than any of us in this day can even possibly imagine.
Thank you, Lord.
And you are able and will accomplish through us things that our brains cannot even conceive.
Wow.
Lord, help us to submit. Mm-hmm. Lord, teach us to trust your power.
Yes, God.
In Jesus' name. So I want you to think about what you aren't doing. We'll go back to Elijah in the cave. God's coming to you and say, why are you here? It's a simple question. What are you doing here? And when you get backed up against the wall and you don't understand anything, one, listen for God's voice. Two, believe he's able and watch what he can do.
Yes.
Going to give a time of invitation. Whatever God leads you to do, I want you to do. Don't waste it. Don't waste this time. You can turn the song off and just get down on your knees or in your heart. Humble yourself and listen to what God would say to you. But don't waste this time.
Amen.
As the song plays, you listen for God.
Amen.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of?
Tell the world of the treasure.